This is joint work with Younjin Kim and Hongbyu. If you think one name is bigger than the other, that's the optical illusion. So, yeah, it's actually the same size. So, I'll start from this classical theorem of Komlosh, Sarkozy, and Samoretti. In 95, what they show is if you have a n vertex graph G, and G has minimum degree at least half plus epsilon times n. Epsilon is some small number. And if T is an n vertex tree, and it has a bounded maximum degree, here delta is some fixed number. And if n is large enough, then what we conclude is this graph G contains this tree T as a subgraph. So let's say that this graph G is a host graph, and T or H we will denote it as a guest graph. So what we want to do is we want to put this guest graph inside of host graph. So I mean, we want to find the subgraph of host graph, which is isomorphic to the guest graph. So what we want to do is we want to generalize this to more stronger theorem or more general theorem. I mean, lots of people actually have generalized this into many directions. So one of the obvious way to generalize this is we consider the more general guest graph. Instead of just 3T, we can consider more general guest graph. So which have been previously considered, and then actually, it was a conjecture of Bolovac and Komlosh until in 2005, both Sir Charles solved it. Let me make sure if the spelling is correct. Yes. So, they show that if G have, again, m vertex graph, and its minimum degree is at least 1 minus 1 over r plus epsilon times n for some integer r, positive integer r. And h is again n vertex graph, and this is r bipartite, and its maximum degree is bounded, and it has small bandwidth, namely sublinear bandwidth, then you can find the subgraph of G, which is isomorphic to H. So here I didn't explain what bandwidth means. Roughly, it's how path-like a graph is. So it's, I'm not going to exactly define what it is, but roughly what it says is that if we have a graph with low bandwidth, then it's easy to actually separate them. So for example, if you have a tree, then you can find the one vertex. If you delete it, then it connects into smaller parts. So it's very easy to do that. So bandwidth is small means that you can somehow still delete small number of vertices to separate them. So for example, this generalizes this because T has small bandwidth. So if T is a tree, then this is trivially bipartite. So R is 2. So this implies that. And not only that, you can consider more general graph, like a powers of Hamilton cycle or some other bounded degree graph with a small bandwidth. So that's obviously one of the directions to go. And another direction is instead of finding just one copy of this T in G, we can try to find more than one copy. So for that direction, let's define what packing means. So we say several graphs, H1 to HS, pack into G if there are edge disjoint copies of H1 to HF in G. So in G, you can find the subgraph isomorphic to H1 and subgraph isomorphic to H2 up to H sub F, and they are all edge disjoint. They do not share the same edge. So for example, if you take a discrete G, then it's easy to actually check that the three triangles pack into G. This is one triangle, and this is another triangle, and this is another triangle. So three triangles pack into G. And if this packing is optimal, which means that there is no leftover edge, then we say this is a decomposition. So regarding generalization of this into packing contact, recently Condon, Kim, Kühn, Osthus proved the following theorem. So if G is an almost M regular graph, and M is say at least half plus root of 1, let's just say epsilon N. So G is again N vertex graph, and almost all of the vertices have the same degree more or less. All the vertex has, in this context, all the vertex has degree 1 plus minus epsilon times M. Yeah. So I will not specify the hierarchy of the constants, but if that holds, and say H1 to HS are trees, so N vertex trees. With bounded degree. Then, one more condition that I forgot. If you add the number of edges in all these trees, then it's smaller than 1 minus epsilon times number of edges in G. Then, this trees pack into G. So here, one more condition is added. Here it's just minimum degree condition, but here it's almost M regular graph, which is actually necessary. We will show why this is necessary later. But this generalized this theorem in the context of packing. So instead of finding one copy, we can find many copies, which are all edge disjoint, and they cover almost all edges. So this is almost optimal up to this epsilon. Actually, I've just written in the form of generalization of this, but actually our theorem here is a generalization of this theorem. So it's not just for trees. This can be all written as bipartite graph with bounded degree and some linear bandwidth. As long as they hold, then actually this number changes, which is a bit. It takes some time to actually explain what number we will get. So I will just write it this way. But this theorem is actually more general. So it works for any R-partite bounded degree, some linear bandwidth graph. If you think about this, this theorem is actually, I mean, both this theorem and that theorem, the original discrete theorem, those are actually sharp. If you try to come up with a sharpness example, it's not really difficult to actually come up with these two examples. So one is, you take kn over 2. Just, let's not worry about the parity of n, because, I mean, it's not really important. So you take a 2 click, and then take the disjoint union. That's one example. And then another example is you take a complete bipartite graph, and one size, this looks bigger, so let's take a plus one here, and one size is smaller. So, these two examples actually shows that those theorems are sharp. So if you want to find the tree, n vertex tree here, on the left hand side, it's impossible to find n vertex tree because this is not even connected. Right? So obviously there is no spanning tree. And here, so it contains spanning tree because it is connected. But if you consider, say, a path of length n, then the unique bipartition of this path is, I mean, when n is even, the unique bipartition of this path is the balanced bipartition. So if this path lives in here, then it must use n over 2 vertices here, n over 2 vertices here, but that is impossible. So this shows that, these two examples shows that that theorem is sharp. But one might say that these examples are very special. These are two special graphs with very rigid structure. Here, rigid structure means it's quite organized. That I mean, there is no edges here, and here everything is an edge, so it has very rigid structure. Then one natural question is that what if we orbit that rigid structure, then you can ask, are this theorem still sharp? So which is actually the theme of another branch of topics in graph theory, which is called Lambda-Turan theory. So similarly, so let me briefly introduce what Lambda-Turan theory is. So we know that Turan theorem says that if the number of edges in G is more than T sub R N, which is roughly half times 1 minus 1 over R N, then K sub R plus 1, you can find the copy of K sub R plus 1 in G. And this is sharp by the Turan graph. You take a complete balanced multipartite graph. But again, this has very rigid structure. In particular, it has a linear size independence. So Lambda-Turan theory asks that what if we add a condition? That independent number of graphs is real of n. So here it means that for smaller enough epsilon, we know that the largest independent set of G is smaller than epsilon times n. Then what happens to this threshold? Does it change? So for example, the easiest case is if you consider the triangle, you know that by Turan theorem, anything over, I mean, if you have a graph with at least n square over 4 edges, then you can find the triangle, and which is sharp. But with this additional assumption, we can actually show that every vertex has small degree. Because If you have a triangle free graph, then every vertex its neighborhood must be independent. But this condition shows that this degree is 0 when so you can actually show that as long as you have at least epsilon n square edges, then you can find the triangle as long as independent number is 0 when. So similarly, it's known that this behavior changes. So I will not write down the exact formula for the Lambda-Strand theory, but Erdős Nagy and Barnabás Erdős and Erdős Hajnal those them already. I mean, each proved the cases for k equal odd. I mean, this r equal odd and even case, and then they figured out how this threshold changes once we assume this independent number of g is real open. And this is for small graph. For small graph embedding, this Lambda-Strand theory studies, I mean, how this threshold on the number of edges changes once you add the additional condition that this graph doesn't have a rigid structure. And recently, people have also considered a large graph. So, it's known that Korodi, 2R, Korodi-Hainer show that minimum degree of G is at least 2N over 3. Then there is a triangle factor in G. Of course, we have to assume that N is divisible by 3. But essentially, this minimum degree condition guarantees that you can find the triangle factor. Your triangle factor is a vertex disjoint triangle, which covers all the vertices. Recently, Barlow, Molla, Sharif-Zadeh show that if we have this condition that the independent number of G is real of N, then this minimum degree bound actually drops. So as long as you have half plus epsilon and minimum degree, then you can still find the triangle factor. And there is generalization of this Korodi-Hainer theorem, which is Hainer-Savoridi theorem. Says that if we have a graph with minimum degree at least 1 minus 1 over R N, then case of R plus 1, wait, no, case of R factor. And recently, Lenzov and Pehova show that if independent number is 0 of N and minimum degree is at least plus epsilon N, then you can find the case of R factor. They consider finding small graph and finding large graph. So what we want to do is, can we do the similar changes to this result? So we have a result regarding decomposition, approximate decomposition of G into large graph, which has minimum degree condition, not minimum degree, but the minimum degree condition. And if we add certain conditions like small no small independent, no large independent set, no small independent number. Then can we drop this bound? So if we
Why? This
regular is linear. Yeah. So, if you think about it, we can make some observation. The first is that this condition is not enough. One difference from before is that in Lambda 2 run, we only consider small graph. And in this large graph, these theorems all consider this KR factor, which is disjoint union of small graphs, so this is very disconnected. But here, we want to consider trees, which are connected graph. So if you consider this graph, then alpha of G is actually 2. If there is 3 vertex, and 2 of them lies in here, or here, then there is an edge. So this has an extremely small independent number, but there is not even one copy of spanning tree. I mean, let alone be a spanning tree, you cannot even find a tree with n over 2 plus 1 vertices. So this is actually not the right parameter to look at. So in order to forbid both examples, we need some other concept. So instead of just independent set, we need two disjoint sets and no edges between. So we need to forbid that structure. Such concept actually already existed. Let's just introduce. Let's say ST bipartite 4. In G is pair of disjoint vertex set. ST are vertex set which are disjoint, and S has size S, T has size T, and there are no edges of G between S and T. So we say that as a TF, no, ST bipartite hole, and then let's write by independence number of G as alpha tilde of G is the largest R such that G contains an ST bipartite hole. For all S plus T and most R. Let's just write equal, it's same. Yeah, obviously ST is not a negative number.
Why is it called a hole? Usually
I mean,
in this cycle.
It's something that's empty. You can suggest a better name if you want. Bipartite emptiness? That's weird, right? Bipartite.
Bistable.
Oh, then maybe. I don't remember whether this name is introduced by someone else or. Yeah, I think it was introduced by, I remember, yeah, McDermid and Yorlov actually introduced it. I think they also used the same name, which I'm not 100% sure, but I think yeah, they have used this, the same name. Anyway, so this was actually, this concept was introduced by McDiarmid and Yolo before, and they show that if minimum degree is at least this parameter, then G is Hamiltonian. So there is a theorem that the minimum degree is at least independent number, then G is Hamiltonian, and they generalize this. So this trivially excludes both cases. We can simply take two sets here, then this contains large bipartite hole. And here, again, we can take two sets here, then this contains large bipartite hole. So, if we use this concept, so this is the right concept to use, then we can actually generalize this into this theorem of ours. So Kim, you. So you can try to figure out which Kim is which Kim. So if we have G, which is an almost M regular. So let's say in this context it is slightly weaker. I mean, concept of almost regular. It means almost all vertices has almost same degree. With say M at least epsilon N. Again, I will just write every small number at epsilon, which has some relationship, but I will just ignore that. And then T1 to TF are 1 minus epsilon N vertex 3 with the maximum degree bounded. And then number of edges in TI sums up to 1 minus epsilon number of edges in G. Then obviously I forgot something, that this contains no large bipartite hole. Then T1 to TS pack into G. So this generalizes this Condon, Kim, Kühn, Osthus. And one different thing is that here this is no longer a spanning tree. This is almost spanning, which is actually necessary. And okay, so let me mention that this theorem is best possible in the sense that both this condition. So I didn't explain you why this M regular, I mean being regular graph is necessary. So this is again necessary in both sense. So this is necessary. And then taking this non-spanning tree is also necessary. So, I mean, obviously, all the other conditions are almost best possible. So this theorem is actually best possible. I mean, not delete one name because that's too important. So, why are these necessary? So, being almost regular is necessary. Is there two S? It feels like it's. Yeah, that is correct spelling, right? I'm always confused whether 2S or 2C. Anyway, the 2C, this, I mean, it's easy that you can consider T1 to TF be 1 minus epsilon n vertex passes. Then if those trees pack into G, in passes, almost all vertices have degree 2. So, if you do basic calculation, if they pack into G, then most of the vertices must have degree half minus, say, epsilon prime S. So, can show that almost all vertices in G must have degree at least half minus epsilon prime S, where epsilon prime is a small number, but it's bigger than epsilon. And yeah, if it's packed into So, if we want to find the almost decomposition, in the sense that these two numbers are very close, then this shows that this graph G must have, I mean, must be almost regular. Because if we want to achieve this condition, this number and this number of edges in HI sums to a number slightly smaller than EG, then we need to ensure that the number of edges of G is at most Sn 1 plus S epsilon times Ns. So from these two conditions, you can actually show that most of the vertices also have, I mean, degree upper bounded. So that shows that this almost regularity is necessary. And let's show that why this graph, this tree must be non-spanning. Yeah, I'm doing some performance in this talk now. So let's consider this. You take x1, vertex x1 and x2. And let's say size of x1 and size of x2 are this is slightly bigger than half n and this is slightly smaller than half n. Then you put a complete bipartite graph here. And what we do is we add two random graphs, Gx1 epsilon and Gx2 epsilon. The epsilon is smaller than delta, but positive. So in here, you add a random graph. Inside of here, you take a two vertex and you flip a coin, which comes up with head with priority epsilon. And then if it is head, you add an S. If it is tail, you don't add an S. You do that independently for all pair. You do the same one here. Then it's actually easy to show that the bi-independence number is at most some constant times log n, which is small, some linear. And consider path, n vertex path. T1 to T quarter minus epsilon n of them. Then we want to pack this into G. So this is G. If you do the computation, these numbers are okay. So this condition is okay. And all other conditions are okay except this one. But what do we know? This is unbalanced partition. So every path, if you embed that in here, you must use at least delta n inside edge. So each ti uses at least delta n inside edge. Then how many inside edges do we need? Delta n times quarter n, so at least say 1/8 delta n square inside edges necessary. However, how many inside edges do we have? These are random graph with so with high priority, the number of edges inside here is at most epsilon n square, and here is at most epsilon n square. But epsilon is smaller than delta, so we don't have enough inside edge. So this tree don't pack to G. Just some small number than 1 over 4. I just took because it's roll bound. Yes, it is. I mean, 1 over 4 minus epsilon, but yeah, let's not confuse it. Yeah. So, if you see this example, one might say that here, it is almost delta, I mean, here, this almost means that the all vertices have almost same degree in the sense that this is delta. So, vertex with the minimum degree and maximum degree, degree difference is roughly delta n times some constant. But later it's epsilon. So, one might say that maybe that's the reason. If you say make it entirely m regular, can you get better? So that's a natural question, but that is actually not the case. Because we can slightly change the before example. You take a balanced partition, and you take a complete bipartite graph between them. And then add a random regular graph here. With say epsilon n log n it. So inside here we add a random regular graph with epsilon n times log n it. And it's not too difficult to actually show that this bi-independent set has some linear size. It requires some computation, but it's, I mean, you don't need a very clever idea to prove that. And we know that this fact is known that the complete ternary tree if you have a complete ternary tree on n vertices and a balanced partition, A, B of this vertex of G. So you have a complete ternary tree and you divide the vertices into two parts. Then, no matter what way you partition it into two same sets, then there exists at least 1 over 17 log n inside edges. So it's, I think it was, you grow it. So it's a binary tree, it's ternary tree. Yeah.
The root is internal processes tree.
Yeah. I think that there was slightly more conditions that I mean how it expands, I mean, to make this happen, but the important part is there exists a tree which satisfies this condition. Then, now you take this complete ternary tree with all n vertex tree, and then that satisfies all the other conditions, and you take the right amount, and then you try to pack it here. Then, you need to use at least this number times n times the number of trees that you take. So some constant times n log n inside that is needed. But this epsilon is small, so this is not possible. So this shows that even if we replace it with the regular, it is not, I mean, possible. Somehow it's already 43, okay, yeah. I think I'm gonna go over time, so I will. Speed up. So it has some relationship with also the topic known as randomly perturbed graph model. So which is introduced by Bowman, Fritz, Martin, that you have a graph G. And then what you want to do is you want to find the subgraph, again, the same way. So let's say you want to find the Hamilton cycle. Then you need the minimum degree n over 2 to do that. Otherwise, there is a counter example. But in this randomly perturbed graph model, what you want to do is you add some random edges. So you have an initial graph, and then you add some random edges, and then you want to find the condition when you get the structure with high priority. So there is a line of research. So for example, if you have a Hamilton cycle, and if you have a graph with minimum degree epsilon n, and then you add on random edge, linearly many random edge, then you get a Hamilton cycle with high priority. So there are lines of research in the lines, I mean, in the along the line. So our result actually can have an application in that sense. So instead of adding this condition, what we can do is, if we have almost M regular graph, and then these are collection of trees, and if you randomly add linearly many edges, then that will guarantee this. After that, you can find this packing. So, yeah, to motivate why we consider this randomly perturbed graph, it actually is related to some other concept. I mean, it's an analogy of some other concept. So in algorithm, there is this algorithm called the simplest algorithm, which give you the optimal solution. In theory, there could be an instance that it doesn't learn fast. But in practice, most of the time, it learns very fast. And people say that why that's the reason. I mean, one of the interpretations is that in reality, most of the cases we want to solve, even if it's very bad cases, there are some random elements acting on the problem. So we are living in a world, so we cannot predict everything. So even if there is bad problem, there are small perturbations there, then the algorithm works very well. I think Daniel Spellman wrote a paper about that, explains what, I mean, that uses certain random perturbation model, and this is a graph analogy of that. Anyway, I'm in hurry, so let me just show you basic proof sketch. So, what you want to, what we use, oh, I have deleted the important name, but let's just forgive me for that. So, one of the tools that we use is a tool developed by Kühn Osthus, Kim Kühn Osthus Tronkin, which is a generalization of Bloch lemma. So, Bloch lemma is that if you have one graph H, which can be partitioned into X1, X2, X3, these are independent sets in H. And then if you have a G, which is B1, B2, B3, and Vi and Xi have the same size, and these are epsilon regular. So epsilon superregular. Meaning that these are some random-like graph, dense graph, which are random-like. Then we can embed this into here. We can find the subgraph of G, which is isomorphic to H. So that's the Bloch lemma. And what we have generalized is that if we have several graphs, all of which have this structure, then we can actually pack them. So we can find the copies of this in G, which are entities to it. So this is the one of the most important tool that we are using. And by using that, I will roughly explain you how we prove this. We have graph G, and we have graph H. T1 to TF and G. So what we first do is we take this G and we apply regularity lemma. Regularity lemma guarantees that we can find the partition of G so that the pairs are epsilon regular. So G has n vertices, and then all the T1 to TF has less than 1 minus epsilon n vertices. So even if we throw away some vertices here, as long as that's less than epsilon n, it is okay. So we throw away some vertices to actually make them superregular. So we can ensure the right, random graph here to invoke this. And also, if you consider this regular partition, we can consider this reduced graph. For each cluster, we put vertices. And then for these two pair, if you have a regular partition with density D, then you add a H with weight D. So this is weighted regular graph. And in this weighted regular graph, we can show that because the original graph is almost regular, this graph is almost regular also. If you count the degree as a sum of weights of these edges that it is incident with. And we know that if you have a almost regular graph, then you can partition it into almost perfect matching. So this is weighted graph, so it is slightly more complicated. So we want to partition it into weighted matching. But essentially, we can partition it into several graphs, and each of them is a matching here. So matching here corresponds to this structure. These are epsilon regular, epsilon regular, epsilon regular. And then we can ensure that the weights here are correct. So this actually is a decomposition of G into G1, G2, G3, several G. And then we take one of them, one at a time. And then now we take T. T is 3, so it is easy to actually scatter them. If you have T, then what we do is we take a vertex T, and then we take its neighbor and neighbor's neighbor, and then we delete them. We repeatedly do that until we have this T1. This is deleted part. And the remainings are very small tree. So you delete certain parts, which is not big. So this is again smaller than epsilon n. Once you deleted it, every component is small. Now we distribute this component into this x11, x12, x21, x22, x31, x32. So we take one of these and then we decide whether to put this in here or here or here. So if we decide to put it here, we put this vertex here, one vertex here, and the other vertex the other side, and then its neighbor here, so that there is no edge inside. For the second one, third one, fifth one, we all distribute it in such a way that this vertices in here is smaller than this vertices here, the number of vertices here is smaller than the number of vertices here. So we can do that because all the TIs are slightly smaller than n. And then, now what we want to do is we want to embed this first. And then we embed the left using that theorem. First, we embed this. So this is B, say A and B. And there is this part, large A, which is connected to here. So this is deleted part, and this is the remaining part, and there is this connection. Then what we do is we embed, say, B here. And we know that A needs to be embedded in this way. This is A. So this specific vertex W, we have to embed W later in here. So we embed B here, and then now we have to also embed A and B. But in order to embed W here, B needs to be embedded here. And in order to embed B here, what we do is, so this is B, and we embed A here and B here. So because this is random-like, there are many choices, linearly many choices of A. So, these are then, so from B to here, as long as we embed A to the neighbor of B, it is okay. So linearly many choice. Once we have linearly many choice, and B can be embedded any vertex here. And this is linear size set, and we know that there is an edge, because it doesn't contain large bipartite hole. So we take an appropriate edge, and then we add it, then we can embed B, A, B. Once we have embedded B, now this W needs to be embedded in the neighbor of B, but so there is certain set, say B sub W, that the W has to be left into B sub W. We do that for all other parts. So for all this deleted one, you can do the similar thing for all vertices, and then we can make the arrangement. Then, at the end, what we obtain is some of the vertices here are used because of this embedding the deleting part. The rest of them are still epsilon superregular. And then the rest of the parts here are waiting to be embedded, waiting to be packed. So we have this situation. One more condition. Some vertices here cannot be mapped to any vertices, but it is specified that it has to go inside. And then it has to go inside in some consistent way. So W1 in H1 has to go in here, and say this is W2, same vertex. And W2 in H also has to go somewhere here, but in such a way that they don't use the same edges from B to here. But yeah, which can be actually ensured. So this can be this can be incorporated in the application of that. So that's not too big problem. But the main part of the proof is that this distribution ensures that we can use this theorem, then we can take it. So that's the roughly how the proof goes. Yeah, it seems that I'm over time, so I will stop here. Yeah, thank you for listening.